Hello and welcome to Berks Business. I'm Bob Wert, Managing Director of Investments of the Wert Investment Consulting Group of Wells Fargo Advisors. Each month on Berks Business, we give you the opportunity to meet the leaders of our regional community and ask questions during our live program. Feel free to give us a call at 610-378-0426. Our guest tonight is John Morahan, who's the President and CEO of St. Joseph Hospital. John, welcome to the program.
Well, thanks very much, Bob. Looking forward to it.
So what's new at St. Joe's?
Well, there's a lot going on at St. Joe's. We really are about ready to celebrate our 140th year of serving Berks County. That comes up on August 22nd since 1873, and preparing really to serve Berks County for another 140 plus years in terms of the kind of innovative healthcare services that we've been known for.
So let's talk about, primary care is something that's definitely expanding, and you've been expanding the network. What's that starting to look like?
Sure. We have been really looking at areas of the county that are underserved in terms of primary care. We have been really working in our next initiative is in Strausstown, Pennsylvania, working with the local community, and later this year we'll be opening up the Strausstown Primary Care Center, which will be staffed by Dr. Sandu and Dr. Robel. We have a small office right in town in Strausstown, but we, working in collaboration with the community, will be moving into the former elementary school right off of Route 183 there, and offering not only primary care services to the community, but also diagnostic services, which in our 14 other satellites, we offer those types of services. We're also building primary care, both in terms of with our own employed St. Joseph Medical Group, and we've just added Dr. Wolf and Dr. Legault, who has been with us for a while, but then Dr. Stroll has joined us in that practice with Dr. Wolf. We also are really working with our physicians that are already still in private practice in primary care, and we've just recently created our alignment organization known as St. Joseph Physician Hospital Organization to really work in tandem with our primary care physicians in terms of delivering cost-efficient, high-quality care and accessible care for our community.
So what's the advantage of having 14 centers scattered throughout the county as opposed to being more centralized?
The key fact is being community-based, people live in the community, work in the community, and accessing medical care locally has several advantages versus trying to consolidate and centralize in one location. In the health system we're evolving into in this country, centralization of some services, which are very kind of the intense or acute type services, it's more than natural to have those in a central location, but you always will want at least a network design of primary care and diagnostic services out in the community where the people live and work.
I believe we have a slide talking about that, the new opening in Strausstown.
There we go. Yeah, that's Dr. Sandu. She recently joined us from the Lehigh Valley. And she, along with Dr. Robel, will be providing care, as they are right now. It's a part-time service, as I mentioned, in town, but with an expanded facility along with other community-based services. Dr. Sandu and Dr. Robel, we believe, with the support of the community up there, which has been absolutely tremendous in terms of the Strausstown community, we anticipate that this will be highly successful.
Terrific. Now let's talk about the technologically. You got a few things going on too in terms of the TAVR and
sure. In terms of other that moving from primary care
right.
to it's kind of the highest innovative cutting edge technology for clinical care is those with heart disease that honestly in the past have been told that it's inoperable in terms of their heart condition, and yet they need to have a valve replaced so that the heart can continue to pump blood
right.
Not only out of the heart but into the whole system for the patient. So our Berks cardiologists have, along with St. Joe's, have pioneered the TAVR procedure, which has really some of the best centers for cardiac care in the United States are offering this at this present time. But we are the first in this region to offer it. And basically what the procedure is that the same technology of using a catheter wire to go up the artery, then thread it into the heart, and then to test in terms of how much blockage a patient has, that same sort of procedure or technology is then the added benefit of this is that they can put a valve that is able to be placed in the current sick valve or disease valve, and it springs open. Mm-hmm. And so therefore blood flow begins in replacing the worn out or damaged heart valve. So that indeed it really is for some of the sickest heart patients who have no other alternative. And heretofore would have to go to a major urban center which would offer this type of procedure. So we're very proud that we are offering TAVR at St. Joe's, and again through the pioneering efforts of Berks Cardiology along with our own highly trained St. Joseph cardiovascular staff, we have been able to offer this new service to the community.
So how does that compare with, say, replacing a heart valve with a pig valve or that sort of thing?
We still, in terms of the main differences, is that replacing it with a pig valve or a traditional is that the chest would have to be broken and go in there and repair it surgically in terms of an open heart procedure. In this procedure, and it's both the cardiologist, interventional cardiologist, that is threading it through the artery to place it there, yet in the same room is the open heart surgeon ready to come to the avail if need be in terms of any assistance that he could offer.
So is the TAVR the new standard for the first choice?
No, TAVR is the kind of the standard of the last resort.
Okay.
You know, it's for very, very sick people that otherwise cannot go through the traditional method of open heart surgery.
And I understand we have a couple slides on that, so let's take a
look
what
just
you got.
I think the first one is just a picture of the whole team.
Okay. Let's see if we have that slide. Or there we go.
Although that's just it's the next slide, but that's Dr. Wolf and Dr. Stroll and Dr. Legault of the primary care, our newest physicians.
Okay. And then we'll come back.
And then
to
here
the,
we go.
There we go. All right.
So, you know, it's just not a heart valve, it's a life preserver, kind of a tagline, but describing kind of the valve in the heart, the procedure, the narrative describes the procedure. Mm-hmm. And I think some of the viewing audience probably have seen that in either the paper on billboards. And then the next slide.
And how long has this been going on?
There's the TAVR team. That really is, it's a collective effort, as you can see, both doctors, nurses, cardiac technicians, and our leading cardiovascular surgeon, the tall physician in the background, is Dr. McMurtry. This has been less than a year, mm-hmm. And that indeed, even prior to this pioneering effort, we were designated more recently a top 50 cardiac hospital in the United States. We're very proud of that designation. It does reflect kind of the clinical excellence in cardiac care that we deliver, again, to the Berks community. And that indeed, that is the team that, along with the nurses in our CCU and on our 2 North in terms of taking care of our heart patients, without them, this kind of center of excellence doesn't occur. And I'm just mighty proud of them.
So if you want to have a center of excellence, if you want to have a lot of people coming through, I gather there's a lot of patients for this kind of procedure in our region.
Well, there is. As a matter of fact, before us offering the TAVR procedure, patients had no other choice but to out-migrate to an urban center that would offer this type of procedure.
Right.
With TAVR, there are, again, these are the sickest of the patients in terms of cardiac disease, and really with the blessing of the patient and the family, like, you know, this is kind of the last procedure.
So how many, I mean, it takes a certain amount of procedures to get good at something.
Yeah.
And how often do they do this?
We're generally averaging about, I would say, 2 to 3 a month. That there, you say a lot of patients, there's patients that have no other choice.
Right.
But it's not as frequent as, say, either cardiac catheterization being done, and then if there's a clogged artery, placing a drug-eluting stent in there to keep it open. It's not as frequent as even doing what was, it's hard for me to say traditional open heart surgery,
right.
But there, in terms of that is more the norm. This is very, even though they're very sick patients, it is not the norm as yet, but we're doing about 2 a month.
Okay, so making progress in that general direction. What other specialties do you have at the hospital?
Well, we're also very, you know, proud of our new partnership, relatively new, mm-hmm. In terms of cancer. Programmatically, we have been aligned with the Penn State Hershey Medical Center for cancer care, the Penn State Hershey Cancer Institute, programmatically for about 4 or 5 years. But more recently, we have aligned our clinical program with them by jointly recruiting both radiation oncology and medical oncology, where Dr. Avito and Dr. Tonquin, respectfully Dr. Ayula, are here providing cancer care in our community and really are full-time at St. Joe's, yet they are affiliated and are on the faculty at Penn State Hershey. But the protocols, we share clinical protocols, we share the cutting edge information and state-of-the-art cancer care that only an academic medical center provides for the benefit of the people in our community. So we're very, very proud of this partnership, and that really is, you know, something that will be seen more and more as we go forward in the future. So, and I think we have a slide on that as well.
All right.
As we talk.
There you go.
So that's Dr. Mark Rivito. That is a current patient in our program. And that is really, as we get talking about the future of healthcare, that woman is really a nurse navigator or a patient care navigator. Mm-hmm. In other words, to help patients and families navigate the care that one receives while being a cancer patient.
Right.
That is really a new role and responsibility in healthcare, and we're proud that we can offer such innovation here in Berks County.
So it's not just an insurance question, it's also a medical question of having somebody to be sort of like a patient advocate or
Correct.
Navigator through the system.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, just honestly, just being given the diagnosis you have cancer, and you can just emotionally what it does to a patient and their family, and we're very honored to be able to provide a person who both understands and empathizes with the journey that that particular patient and family are on, and then indeed they're able then in terms of counsel and advice relative to what the patient will experience, whether it be a medical route, a surgical route, or a radiation route, or a combination thereof, in terms of that patient's journey, in terms of curing their cancer.
Okay. So we talked about heart, cancer. How about the vascular? And
Vascular, in terms of cardiovascular, I mentioned Dr. Right. McMurtry leading our cardiothoracic program. Dr. Pat Sharma, Chief of Surgery, leads our vascular program. We are currently looking at innovative ways that we can work with Penn State Hershey and Dr. Sharma's practice in terms of providing some cutting-edge vascular care here. We've been working more recently with the Chief of Vascular Surgery at Penn State Hershey, Dr. Amy Reed, who she herself provides some coverage for our vascular program at St. Joe's. So stay tuned for that. We are looking at doing some innovation there. We're also building up our capabilities in what we call the neurosciences. Mm-hmm. And just this week, we have recruited a new neurologist to join Dr. Majeed. Dr. Tyler has joined us. So we're looking at expanding our capabilities in neurology. And in neurosurgery, we do have an initiative, again, with Penn State Hershey, where what's known as telemedicine, but basically that we have the ability in our emergency department of a patient coming in with a stroke-like condition, then indeed our ED and consults intervene at our level, and to get a second or third opinion, we're able to bring the telestroke equipment, which is basically really a camera, sound, very similar to what we're doing here tonight, and a computer terminal to print out the information. But that real-time access and real-time diagnosis and consultation is occurring between the specialists at Penn State Hershey and the St. Joe's specialists and ED docs right in our ED. And so therefore, stroke patients coming to St. Joe's have the best cutting-edge care and being directed as to, you know, what interventions do we need to do at St. Joe's, right, stabilizing them at St. Joe's, treating them at St. Joe's. But if their condition is very, very severe, where it's appropriate for them to be in an academic medical center, then they are transferred to Penn State Hershey.
Super. Let's take a moment for a break for Berks Community Television.
You're watching Berks Business on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. To read other stories concerning local businesses, go to www.bctv.org.
Hey, welcome back to the second half of our program. I'm Bob Wert, Managing Director of Investments of the Wert Investment Consulting Group of Wells Fargo Advisors. Our topic tonight is the St. Joseph Regional Health Network, and our guest tonight is John Morahan, who's the President and CEO. We've been talking the first half of the program about what's going on at St. Joe's. Let's talk a little bit more broadly now about what's going on in healthcare in general. A couple things have happened in the last year or two.
Well, just a few.
Just a few.
And they were occurring before the Accountable Care Act, but now it's the law of the land, and the Supreme Court upheld that. Mm-hmm. That indeed, there are, and you know, very significant changes that are occurring both on the health delivery side as well as the payment side or the health insurance side in terms of how both physicians and hospitals and nursing homes and honestly extended care workers, everybody that's involved in healthcare will be paid in the future. And that indeed we're really in the midst of transformational change. Mm-hmm. And very similar as I tell people that when they ask, well, it must be like the Industrial Revolution that our ancestors experienced here, except with information technology and the speed as well as access of that information. But it's kind of like the Industrial Revolution occurring, but it's on steroids, you know, because it's occurring that quickly because the information is readily available.
So much of that information technology, or what else is going on?
Well, technology as well as the ability to both analyze and compare and really in many respects be able to profile diseases that heretofore we didn't have the collective information. We had disparate studies, mm-hmm, and you would have to read the trade magazines if you were a physician, say. But now we have this information really collated, consolidated, and that indeed and they're known as the best evidence-based practices, right, so that indeed if you're, you know, all hospitals and physician offices are converting to electronic health record rather than a patient, or rather a paper medical record, mm-hmm, for the patients, and that indeed it really is the ability to really have that right at the ready in terms of if a patient with heart disease or pulmonary disease comes in, you can just queue up on your iPad, your laptop, the best treatment protocols for that particular disease for that patient.
So where do you draw the line between physician judgment and expertise versus what the computer tells you to do? How do you balance that?
That is where the art and the science of medicine merge,
right,
and it is even more so that at the end of the day, you trust and rely upon the physician's medical judgment, but it's bolstered by this information.
Then does payment,
much the same for nursing care, too.
Does payment follow procedure? So you get paid if you do this, but you risk, take risks if you don't do what they tell you to do?
That's a very good question. Then in terms of what we get paid for now, mm-hmm. is seeing the patient and providing care,
right.
and or paying for volume, meaning paying for each occurrence,
yes.
that occurs. What is occurring and where we're going is getting paid for value or delivering the best outcome for the patient, mm-hmm. based upon the best scientific information that is at the ready in terms of information technology.
So how do you measure value?
You measure value, or the insurance companies, honestly, or the payers,
right.
measure value by predictable, consistent outcomes and delivering those consistently at a high quality rate at the most efficient cost. So high quality, cost efficiency are the mantras going forward in the future.
Now, does that kind of a system penalize a hospital that takes on the sickest patients?
Not necessarily. If your delivery system has really embraced the ability to leverage the information, mm-hmm. have the appropriate skill set in your physicians and nurses and other health professionals, that you can take on the sickest patients and that you can deliver high quality, consistent outcomes, you will be rewarded.
Okay.
And honestly, in discussions with the payers, that is recognized.
Okay. That's kind of now. There's more than one business model in healthcare delivery these days, even in our county. What are the differences?
Sure. Well, I think that what you'll hear more about as you read and as you hear more about what's happening in the transformation of healthcare is that all hospitals and physicians in partnership are on a path towards building what is known as clinically integrated networks. These clinical integrated networks really are an alignment mechanism, and really almost like it's both a delivery alignment as well as an organizational alignment, so that you can take on payment risk, eventually payment risk, or being responsible for the health of a population. So a health of 1,000 patients, 5,000 patients, 10,000 patients. And honestly, Medicare has these programs right now, mm-hmm. And more so as we go forward in the future. And so there's many ways of organizing a clinical integrated network. At St. Joe's, we have made the decision, rather than having a complete employment, particularly of our primary care and specialists, that we will align, noting that there are still, and robustly, the private practice of medicine is still in vogue in Berks County, which is great, mm-hmm. and that indeed we don't need to own all the components of the physician side. We have the acute care side and surgical side at St. Joe's, and then the rehab side we will also have to contract out with our participating or preferred providers of rehab. But getting back to the physician side, mm-hmm. is that the way to align that is to create a provider health organization, and I think the public will start hearing more about St. Joseph PHO. That's a short acronym for provider health organization, which allows us, both doctors and hospitals, to align our interests in improving the quality of care we deliver to this community, but to do so cost efficiently, and also to negotiate and be able to work with the insurance companies and Medicare and Medicaid in terms of us, this organization, us collectively together, providing this care and taking contracts on to take care of those patients.
So how do you handle the information flow both internally, because you have your own network and you've got quite a bit of data,
mm-hmm.
and then there's another organization in town that also has a certain amount of data. What happens if a person who's a patient in one organization ends up, say, in an automobile
sure.
accident? And how does that information
yeah.
flow?
Well, first of all, that all, you know, as I mentioned, all of us, doctors, both hospitals, are moving towards an EHR. The Reading Health System has just deployed Epic.
Okay.
That's
what are
a brand
acronyms?
Name. Electronic Health Record. We are going with a company known as Cerner. But, you know, at some point, but also that The nursing homes in the area have different EHRs, electronic health record systems. Doctors have varying different kinds of electronic health records. So there's a thing called a health information exchange, which is both an interface for this data, as well as, and that's will have give the ability to share information between ourselves. But more importantly, there's also, there's, you know, with all these, you know, you get an iPhone. In fact, I was coming down tonight, Highmark is advertising their app for Health Styles, if you're a subscriber for Highmark. Well, much the same, there are information companies, software-based, that offer really population health software so that you can look at the full health of a person and even get data feeds in from hospitals, doctors, even drugstores.
How much of that is in the here and now, and how much of that coming attractions?
What I just talked about, this population health software, is here and now.
Okay.
And there's four or five main companies. The health insurance companies are offering them. Yeah. There's independent companies that you can use, and so this is already today. What is coming tomorrow is PHOs, clinical integrated networks, absolutely utilizing that information in order to effectuate change to provide better high quality health care for a patient from the doctor's office all the way through to the end of the acute surgical care rehab system. That leveraging that information is coming forward in the future in the next couple of years.
And also here, you mentioned the nursing homes as well as will be partners at some point.
Nursing homes and home health agencies, absolutely critical as we go forward in the future in terms of people being rehabbed in a low-cost, high-quality setting, and a lot of care in terms of both self-care for the patient, that more responsibility but accountability because we'll have monitoring tools available, as well as that, you know, in terms of home health, being able to deliver services more effectively in a setting that the patient and family are comfortable in.
So the minute or so we have left, how do you navigate all this? There's a lot of change coming here.
Yeah, I have a great team, which I do at St. Joe's in terms of the people, and it is really transformational. I'm very proud to say that we at St. Joe's and our leadership team, including the board and the medical staff, have really gone on this journey even before we built the new hospital. It wasn't about building a new hospital. It was about building the right kind of facility for this future. And I'm happy to say that, you know, St. Joe's, in terms of the recognition that it's received, both with Pathways to Excellence, our most recent award, in terms of recognizing the high quality and nurse empowerment that we provide our nursing staff, to the top 50 cardiac hospital in terms of the business group known as Leapfrog, getting an A rating in quality of care, and then the creation of the St. Joseph Provider Health Organization. We are making the right steps for a preferred future.
Terrific. John, well, thank you for being a guest in Berks Business.
Thank you, Bob.
Our guest has been John Morahan, who is the President and CEO of the St. Joseph Health Network. I'm Bob Wert, Managing Director, Investments, Wells Fargo Advisors. Thank you for joining us on Berks Business.